three of them so far. One is a center for spintronic integrated systems. Another is research organization of electrical communication, which specializes in disaster tolerant or resistant information communication technology, and Center for Innovative Integrated Electronic Systems, which I will briefly discuss about the role of these at the very end of my talk. So, early research achievements done at the actually Department of Electrical Engineering, which was established in 1990, include Yagi Uda directional antenna, which was invented here in 1929. And you probably can see still many of the households worldwide has this herringbone-like antenna, which was actually invented here by Professor Yagi and Professor Uda. There's split anode magnetron, which we still use today. And every household actually has this because it's a source of microwave for microwave optics. And AC bias magnetic recorder was established here in 1937 with this wire magnet is being used to record information there. So based on these activities, Research Institute of Electrical Communication, which institute was established in 1975. So this research institute has begun its life as a place to do research conducted by professors at the Department of Electrical Engineering. And it was supported by actually the CITO Gratitude Foundation, CITO Home, which had actually several $100 million fund at the time. And for the specific study on communication utilizing electricity, subject they donated approximately $15 million grant from today's currency. All right, after these, the establishment, research achievements made here at Research Institute of Electrical Communication include three elements of optical communication by Professor Ishizawa, semiconductor laser proposal, graded index optical fiber, and PI bias. Here's Professor Ishizawa. Static induction transistor, pyrometronic computer, metal particle magnetic tape, surface acoustic wave filter that we use in our cell phones, and particularly recording, which is the basis of today's cloud technology. And this was invented by Professor Iwasaki in 1977. And all those hard disk drives that is produced, that are produced today are perpendicularly recorded. And the two professors, Nishizawa and Iwasaki, received the order of engineering from their brothers. Also, additional note here is that Dr. Matsuoka, who is a professor emeritus of our institute, is actually a graduate from Professor Nishizawa's group, and he invented a flash wave, which we also use every day. So these are the major achievements. And there are many others which I did not include here. So today, our mission, the Institute's mission is such that we declare that we investigate and establish scientific principles and apply technologies aimed at creating communication technologies that enrich humanity and serve as a center. And we also would like to serve as a center for information and communication research in Japan, and hopefully one of the centers in this global world as well. For such purpose, we have four institutions, two research laboratories, one research center, and we are host, we're having 24 groups in those organizations. Research divisions are conducting long-range basic research, and they are divided into information devices division, broadband engineering division, human information systems division, and systems and software division. Of course, although we call it division, they're not divided. We're collaborating each other every day, including two laboratories, a laboratory for nanoelectronics and electronics, a laboratory for brainware systems, which we develop ESI based on principles we learn from brain functions. And these are more middle term, like 10 years, and long term, long range meaning 20 years horizon. And the shorter ones, a 5-year horizon, we create new information communication technology by industry, university cooperation. And as I said, we established three different centers and research organizations university-wide, and we are in the process of establishing yet another one, inter-university center for performance education and research. This includes actually not only Tohoku, but also University of Tokyo, Osaka University, and Keio University. All right. I will not go into the details, just to give you a flavor of the research field that we are conducting on this in this building and at the Research Institute. This is the slide starts with quantum information technology, actually conducted by Professor Lavanzi sitting there. The CHOES group is working on a ferroelectric mass storage system. Here it's an example of Nishiyama Hashi team showing wireless magnetic motion capture system. Suzuki Sakamoto team is working on accurate accurate sound space communication system. Professor Nakazawa is leading Nakazawa Hiroyoshida group in optical fiber communication, leading the world. Murauka group is working on storage system, and Ohori Sensei, who's sitting there, is working on a state-of-the-art compiler based on SML Sharp developed here. Kitamura Sensei is working on this interactive content. Actually here, he has shown and demonstrated, depending on the environment, the discussion, the shape of the desk that you're using can change, for example. And at the two laboratories, my group is developing a spintronic technology, which I will have more time to discuss later on. Professor Iwano is working on organic field transistors, and another group is running a system on neural network or a snake-like motion robot that is based actually on learning how snake is moving, and other integrated circuit based on brain function, as I said. And here is the AIM storage system. There are only representatives of the activities here, and I have not included all of them. But I can see many faces here doing wonderful research upstairs, we will have a brochure of our research institute, and there you will find more about our activities. So, briefly, the operation of our research institute, I will just give you an idea of the budget. We are operating approximately about $30 to $50 million, and half of which, which is the yellowish part, is coming from the external fund. So, and the basic university level support is a green part, and these are for facilities. So these are the idea of how much we're spending at the research institute. And one of our activities is to act for as a promote international academic exchange agreements. Eight university level agreements, meaning that eight are we are responsible. Our research institute is responsible for these eight, and also there are 10 department level or research institute level agreements, starting from Polish Academy of Science in 1976. Two examples or representatives of these activities agreements is one by this Harvard University. We signed the first agreement in 2010, and we extended it last year in May 2022. We also have MIT, Research Laboratory of the Electronics Department level agreement, and that is has a very active, spent a very active year in 2015, having many meetings together, including students. This building that you're in has been completed in 2014, November, and we had a grand opening last year. So it has six stories, 13,000 plus square meter floor space, and seismic isolation structure, so you will be safe if you get another one today. All right, and we celebrated, it happened to be 80th year anniversary last year. So we celebrated Research Institute's 80th anniversary. And I will not go into the details, but I have quoted a former director, Professor Ishizawa, as a speech, which was delivered, he delivered at Research Institute of Electric Communication. 50th anniversary, so 31 years ago. And he, at the time, declared that it is our mission to start studies on new research fields before the field is named. So we have to keep that in mind during this. All right, so that is the introduction to the Research Institute, and I will give you a brief introduction about the activities as a joint UCH research center. So what is this joint UCH research center? And this is one scheme that Minister of Education came up with. And before it was called, a National Research Center in 2008, and they changed the scheme, and now it's called Joint UCH Research Center. Well, actually, there are centers. So the Ministry of Education has identified each center for each field to conduct collaborative research, to access major research equipment. We don't have this, so we are aiming at focusing on conducting collaborative research. But other centers can have major research equipment like hydroclimate laboratory, which is being hosted by the Institute of Material Research on this campus. Or it can have a large quantity of document and data beyond the So this is, so groups from other universities, we are open to other universities as well as industry, domestic as well as international, to conduct collaborative research on information and communication technology. That's our mission, our research is the mission with respect to this joint research center. So we have, to do this, we have a formative research project, and many of you are being part of this formative research project, otherwise you will not be here, I believe. And we have four categories: nanoelectronic devices using physical phenomena, new systems for broadband communication, information systems for human and environment communication, and a system and software for information society. So the categories are recently brought so that we can include many new things here as a cooperative research. So the number of projects that we are conducting is reaching 100. We are still at the fiscal year 2015, which ends next month, March 2016. And the number of people involved in this cooperative research program or project is now reaching more than 500. That we are really happy seeing this number. Okay, whether the project types, I will not go into the details, but starting from international collaboration to a very unique idea, or exotic, I should say, to promote new developments in this field. And the budget wise, we are limited in a sense. This is coming from the Ministry of Education, and it's about a month of $1 billion. And we are adding our own fund. We make it to slightly less than, I should say, $500,000 to distribute into 100 groups and for collaborative research. The outcome so far is, I would say, impressive. These are the outcomes of as a national project. So people who have successfully gotten funding based on the research, cooperative research programs. And we are naming those who are outside our research institute. So we are not just taking advantage of having cooperative research programs, projects, but people are utilizing this scheme as a vehicle to successfully getting their fund granted. So we are happy seeing these very successful programs on this list. Okay, so that's about activities of as a joint research center. And I will very briefly, the remainder of time, I think I still have 15 minutes or so. I would like to give you an example of how a cooperative research project evolved into a major research activity here. So this research was conducted at the Laboratory for Nanoelectronics and Spectronics. We have in 1984, we established a laboratory for microelectronics with state-of-the-art equipment. And at the time, people who were involved are Professor Nishizawa, at the very planning stage, Professor Omi, very unfortunately, he passed away this week. Tsugouchi, Shibata Sensei is in the audience, and Rota Sensei, many others. It's a major effort. And it's being supplemented by a new building, and we renamed it as a Laboratory for Electronic Intelligence Systems. People involved, Nakajima Sensei, for example, father says it was director at the time. And in 2004, we established collaborative electronics and electronics, and utilizing fully the 2002 stimulus package, constructed this new, yet new thing that we are currently being used. And this laboratory is a host of university-wide centers and systems. Okay, so when I was, I joined Tokyo University, it was 1994. I took an advantage of this joint research project, which is now called Cooperative Research Project, and they organized a symposium, and actually there were more than 50 teams involved in this activity. And everything started from here, where, and at the time we were working on physics and applied application of stimulated phenomena and semiconductors. We're still working on it, but it evolved into a major outcome. Like this slide shows that we have first shown that we can make non-magnetic semiconductors, specifically in this case gallium arsenide, ferromagnetic. So we can make semiconductors that we can use for lasers and transistors, ferromagnetism. And this particular paper, we're not going to the details here, published in 2000 by Thomas Dietl, who was a professor at the time at this research institute, who is now back in Poland as a Polish Academy of Sciences, together with myself and many others. This paper actually has been cited more than 5,000 times, which is the highest that Tokyo University has produced. Okay, and based on this, you will hear more about electric field control of magnets later on in the second half of the morning session from Professor Matsukura. So I will not go into the details, but because the nature of ferromagnetism is carrier induced, we can change the number of carriers and we can change the magnetic properties by changing the carrier numbers, in other words, by gating. So this is the first time that we show, also at low temperature, we can change the property of the magnetic phase of a material by not changing the temperature, but changing the applied electric field. So this is, this shows the magnetism in everyday life, starting from back in 5th century BC, we can find Greek literature describing magnetism, or rather lodestone. And since then, we are dealing with magnetism in the form of compass, or magnetic recording, artist lines, electrical motors. This, I think, we should discuss with later. And we all have refrigerator magnets and refrigerator. But here, the usage is such that we use magnets as made, and we do not change its property after making a magnet. But unlike semiconductor, but we have shown here that we might be able to change its property by gating it afterwards to get more function from it. Another front, which is actually related to what I have just described, is to another front that spintronic technology is being applied is to meet the challenges of very large scale integrated system technology is facing. The two obstacles are power consumption and interconnection delay. So this is standby power, power as well as active power. So even if you're side, consumes a lot of assembler, almost comparable to your active power. And this is because the high performance transistors leak. A transistor leak, and you have billions of them, so you cannot stop current from running. Another thing is integration. Today, a memory and logic block are separated, and you have to spend the penalty of this layout is that you will have to wait for some time for the information to arrive at logic and put it back together. And this also costs you power. The idea that we have is very simple. First, we would like to use non-volatile memory as opposed to volatile memory that you have to constantly use the power to keep your information there. And then, so we can make it immediately to some degree the LSI cleaner. And if those memory devices are not made of semiconductors, we do not have to put it aside logic, but we can put it on top of logic. And that can make your integration delay and power much, much reduced. Very briefly, the length scale here is, let's say, 1 millimeter. But here, it's 1 micron. So it can immediately reduce the length from interconnection lengths, 3 orders of magnitude. That has a great impact. Of course, it involves a lot of design change, a lot of materials development, a lot of processing, and many, many things. But this is something that we are aiming at and we are now trying to demonstrate. This is indeed the way forward. So for this, we need non-volatile memory, and we already have non-volatile memories, like flash memory that we're using every day. And this is a great device for providing a low-cost bit, a huge number of bits. But for our purpose, using on-chip non-volatile memory. Using non-volatile memory on chip, it does not have good attributes for this particular application. And currently, the only known option for utilizing non-volatile memory together with CMOS in the environment of LSI is spin device. And here is an example of spin device. We have two magnets separated by a very thin insulator so that the electrons can tunnel through it. But the resistance of the device depends on the configuration of the two magnets. And thereby we can record memorize 0, 4, and 1 on this single device. So this is the device that I have just described. There are other variations, but I'm not going to give details here. But the technology development was not straightforward. You might think that having magnets, these blue and green are magnets. Having magnets, in a magnetization direction, basically the north pole, south pole direction, in plane or out of plane is not terribly important. But it actually is, just like the perpendicular magnetic recording, we're making in-plane to perpendicular because it has revolutionized the industry. And here, I'm not going into the details, but making the direction perpendicular to the plane was very critical in getting high performance magnetic tunnel junction. Because we are making tunnel junction with that two magnets. And this is not in the book, but you're not supposed to read this. This is the state of magnetic tunnel junction development early in 2010. Everybody knew that you have to go to perpendicular configuration, and people struggled. This is P means perpendicular. Struggled to make it work. So this means that we can get a very good resistance change between the two configurations that I just mentioned. This means that you can change the configuration by going on the threshold current. So when you have good resistance change, you cannot change, at least keep within the current switching. And if they, when they report current switching, they do not at least report a good resistance change. So clearly, compiling all the publications at the time, you see that the field had a problem. So they tried many material systems, but they couldn't get a good magnetic tone junction that can give you a good resistance change as well as good switching capability. But in 2010, we showed that actually it's a very standard material system going to very thin magnets, thinner than people have thought or experimented before. And we showed that we can get very easy, very nice magnetic protection. So this was, maybe to some extent, of course, for us, it was highly reproducible. So all the laboratories, including industrial ones, immediately reproduced this and decided to go to this direction. And that actually changes the scene that we have been seeing in industry as well as in the academia. Okay, I will skip many slides. So very briefly, we've been experimenting on utilizing the technology that I've just mentioned and showing that we can actually reduce mostly the power by as much as two orders of magnitude compared to conventional CMOS realization. This is a microcontroller we reported in 2014. And these are made from configurations. And this is actually the industry standard, and this is the only way we can make such a large-scale integrated circuit. It's a lot of effort. For example, we don't have an access to this one, but it costs $10 million to get this one. So we had to go through many collaborative schemes. But very fortunately, because of this, industry has been convinced with this approach, industry has donated a new clean room facility. And we are now having 300-millimeter wafer process tools, at least on magnetic part. All right, so this is the last slide. What we are trying to show and convince the world is that it's been always the limit of power consumption that promoted the change of technology. And we believe that spintronics-based WSI will be the way for the future, and that's how people will make their WSI in the years to come. So I think I used all my time, so thank you very much for attention, and I'm happy to